Is the Apple TV a game console? Lots of gamers would say no. I say that it is, except that it doesn't include a game controller. The SteelSeries Nimbus Plus is that controller. It is the missing piece that brings fun back into gaming. Seriously, the 2021 Apple TV has powerful hardware. Apple Arcade has fun software. But to unlock all of that software, a controller is needed. Oh sure, they're not all AAA games, but do you know what's the best-selling game on a single platform? It's Wii Sports. While not super impressive graphically, that game is a lot of fun, and with over 82 million sales, the controller made a huge difference. While pushing pretty pixels is important, games are about having fun. There's lots of fun to be had on Apple Arcade. However, with an Apple TV, many games simply require a controller. So, to get that console experience, I needed a game controller. I looked at the options, and there are many. Apparently, certain Xbox or PlayStation controllers can be paired with the Apple TV. I don't have any of those controllers, though. The latest consoles I have are from 15 years ago. During the previous decade, mobile gaming was good enough for me. That was until it turned into an in-app purchasing mess. Apple Arcade changes that, as advertisements and in-app purchases are prohibited. So, the controller is the missing piece. But that is a fairly expensive piece. The SteelSeries Nimbus Plus has a suggested retail price of $69.69. That seemed high to me, as the most expensive controller I had before that was the NES Advantage. That was only $50. But of course, that was 1987. The equivalent in 2021 dollars is over $120. Wow, inflation. Still, $70 seemed pricey. Also, the controller was released over a year ago. Is there nothing better? After some searching, I saw that AT&T was having a huge sale. The SteelSeries Nimbus Plus was $25 off. Nice. So, I got one. Surprisingly, the controller arrived super fast. It was at my house the next day. So there it was, inside a big white box. And it says it right there on the front, made for iPhone, iPad, iPod, and Mac. Even at $45, the SteelSeries Nimbus Plus is expensive compared to other alternatives, but this controller is specifically made for Apple gaming. Those two words are not commonly associated with each other. Apple, gaming. That almost sounds like a contradiction. But now, that's starting to change. Apple is showing signs of building something great. Yet, it's more on the casual side. That's why I was surprised by the words that greeted me inside of the box. For glory. While that slogan might make sense for other SteelSeries gear, that's not why I play Apple Arcade. I picked this controller because I wanted something that just works. To test that ease of use, I completely disregarded the warning label on the outside of the box. It said, "To ensure compatibility with all iOS devices, we strongly suggest that you update the controller using the SteelSeries engine on a PC or Mac via Lightning cable before you start gaming." Yeah, I'm not doing that. I immediately went to games like Crossy Road Castle, Star Trek Legends, and Zen Party Pinball. All of them worked just fine. But perhaps the "For Glory" slogan is applicable here, as that was one of the surprising aspects of using this controller. I do admit that part of the reason I bought this controller was to play better. I thought that the standard Apple TV remote was limiting. However, the D-pad on the SteelSeries Nimbus Plus is loud and clicky. It didn't really help me to play better. Not directly. Not in this game. But the way Crossy Road Castle works, I could simply add a second player and do nothing with it. That additional player just stood there in reserves. Playing like this, I did better than with any online group before. I got to an all-time high of level 103 on the Great Treehouse. But before the score could register, I reset the game. This felt like cheating. The controller is so powerful that just sitting on the couch next to me was enough to improve my game. That's nuts. But seriously, it did do what it was supposed to do, which was unlock the games I couldn't access on my Apple TV. Finally, I could play Star Trek Legends. Again, I was surprised. There were some parts that were not so great, such as selecting your team. This game plays better with a mouse or a touchscreen. That's not really a fault of the controller. It wasn't until I started playing Zen Party Pinball that I started to appreciate the new controller. Wow, using the triggers as flipper controls, that felt great. I ripped right through that game, collecting 3 stars on every table, even DreamWorks Animation's Troll Pinball and My Little Pony Pinball. Those left and right index finger buttons are Hall Effect magnetic triggers. Perhaps that's overkill for pinball, but wow, the flippers were nice and responsive. That's when I started to realize that this thing has a lot of buttons. In addition to all the game-related buttons, there are 3 buttons in the middle: Options, Home, and Menu, to help with navigation on Apple devices. I still end up using the Apple TV remote for navigation though, as it can detect swipes. With the Apple TV remote, there's a dedicated button for going to the home screen, if you set it up to do that. This is also great for quitting apps, as it's just a double tap and a swipe. I don't know how to do that with the SteelSeries Nimbus Plus. What's also cumbersome is that both of these devices need charging, but that's why I chose the SteelSeries Nimbus Plus. It has a lightning port, so I can use the same cable to charge both the remote and the controller. Surprisingly, the controller did not include a cable. With a $70 suggested retail price, that's kind of absurd. The controller ships in a fancy nest of packaging. It's meant to make a good first impression. And yet, I was digging through it, trying to find some extras, only to find disappointment. Where's the lightning cable? It's not included. The product information guide states, to charge your Nimbus Plus, plug an Apple Lightning cable, not included, into the Lightning charge port and connect it to a power source. That document is not as prominent as the outside of the box, which I found to be a little confusing. The box itself says, easily recharge using your Lightning cable. I think that should have been more clear. If you have an Apple device, it's very likely that you already have a lightning cable. However, many of them are frayed and are in poor shape. I would have enjoyed getting a new lightning cable, as I would have put it to good use. As another example of confusion with the box, it has a battery-shaped icon that says 50 plus H, which I assume means hours, but immediately underneath it it says, built-in rechargeable battery, 30 hours of play on a single charge, so you won't need to worry about running out of power. I don't like being so fussy, but I think that could have been explained better too. Why are there 2 numbers? That's a big difference. So I looked at the press release. It says the following. With its iPhone mount and an amazing 50 hours of battery life, Nimbus Plus is the ideal companion to games on the App Store and Apple Arcade that feature controller support, such as Sneaky Sasquatch, Butter Royale, and Crossy Road Castle, said Craig Olson, president of Worldwide Mobile at SteelSeries. We've added many other new features, making Nimbus Plus the new global standard in mobile gaming performance. Perhaps the difference is a cushion to help protect against battery degradation. I'm not sure, but what I am sure about is that I never ran out of power with the SteelSeries Nimbus Plus. There is a battery level button on the top side of the controller. Pressing the button lights up the LEDs and shows the power remaining. 4 bars is greater than 75%, 3 bars is 50 to 75%, 2 bars is 25 to 50%, and 1 bar is less than 25%. I haven't seen it lower than 3 bubbles, so it's got plenty of power. But what if not? What if the battery went bad and I wanted to repair it? How repairable is the SteelSeries Nimbus Plus? Well, right away, I learned that opening the controller is not something that is encouraged. It's held together by tri-wing screws, I don't have that kind of screwdriver. It's the second time this month that I needed one. I solved this problem by jamming a small flathead screwdriver into the space. I was able to remove the screws, but obviously this method is not recommended, as I partially stripped the screws. With four screws removed, the controller could be opened a little bit, but it still was firmly held together. I have an iFixit opening tool, which is basically a tiny pry bar. This opened the case a little more by releasing the two tabs at the top. And yet, it still would not open. That's because there's a fifth screw underneath the label. Very sneaky. There's even an extra depression in the middle, which felt like a screw underneath the label, but it's not. So, I just removed the whole label. Again, this is clearly not encouraged, as it is extra sticky. Even after several minutes of cleaning, the controller was still a bit of a mess. So I used some Goo Gone, and that cleaned it up nice. Very smooth. With that last screw removed, the inside of the controller was accessible. While not super easy, and I don't have any extra parts, it's nice to know that I could replace the battery, if necessary. This also solved the mystery of the little rubber piece in the middle. I wasn't sure if it did something important. I thought it might have been for a headphone jack, but there's nothing there. It's just covering a hole. So, after that little adventure in repair, I checked to see if I could turn the controller back on. It's always a nice feeling to put something back together, after taking it apart, and it works. With the pulsing red light, I could see that my little experiment was successful. I learned a lot more about the controller. Those red lights are a little ominous, though. It reminds me of Kit from Knight Rider. I can practically hear that swooshing sound as the car drives towards a crime-fighting mission. You can take the controller on your next adventure, as the SteelSeries Nimbus Plus includes an iPhone mount. This setup is essentially a portable gaming console, which is nice. Although, once again, the box is confusing. It says compatibility with the iPhone SE, but it doesn't specify which generation. The original one from 2016 doesn't stay in the cradle. The phone just flops around because it's too small to be gripped by the mount. This might be a non-factor, as that is an older iPhone, but surprisingly, Apple is still supporting it, as the iPhone SE original is listed as compatible with iOS 15. But as a comparison, the second generation iPhone SE worked just fine. It fit perfectly in the iPhone mount, especially with the grippy sides of a smartish case. I was able to connect the SteelSeries Nimbus Plus to both my iPhone and Apple TV without any big trouble. I don't like shuffling between both devices though. While trying to pair the controller with my iPhone, my Apple TV and my TV turned on. It can be quite unsettling to others when they see the TV turn on for no apparent reason. In conclusion, here's the good and not so good about the SteelSeries Nimbus Plus. The controller feels great. It reminds me of an original Xbox controller, but this one is the right size, not too big and not too small. It's not heavy, but it feels solid. It works well with Apple Arcade. It's so good that Apple should include it with the Apple TV. A lot of the games on Apple Arcade simply won't work without a controller. What's nice about this controller is that it's specifically designed for this environment. The trigger buttons are really good. While playing Zen Party Pinball, I was slamming those buttons. The SteelSeries Nimbus Plus handled it without a problem. Now here's what's not so good. I'm not happy with the box design. First, it's a little too pretentious. While I do like the bright orange color, I'm not into the whole for glory mindset. This controller was primarily purchased to play inaccessible Apple Arcade games. While competitive gaming is somewhat a factor, as I am ranking respectably on several leaderboards, Apple gaming is different. And from my perspective, it's a refreshing change of pace. It's casual gaming, with a lot of creativity. While there are games where you can compete with other players, Apple Arcade is not in your face about it. The environment is cleaner, more friendly, and I like that a lot. I play games to remove stress, not create it. As for the second issue with the box, I feel like the information could have been presented better. Exactly which model of the iPhone SE is supported? Is it the first generation, the second generation, or both? Also, what's the difference between battery hours and play hours? But most importantly, I was surprised that the lightning cable was not included. This is a $70 controller, but it doesn't even include the necessary cable to charge it. And the last item on this list, the D-pad is too clicky. I would have preferred a more mushy and silent control pad. It just doesn't match with the rest of the controller, where the buttons feel and sound just right. Overall, I'm happy with the controller. The SteelSeries Nimbus Plus moves the Apple TV deep into game console territory. It's been more than a decade since I enjoyed gaming like this. The Apple TV, Apple Arcade, and now the controller, it's a great gaming combo.